Flash sonar is a way of seeing with sound. You're sonifying the environment with flashes of sound. That would be a bit like illuminating the environment with dim flashes of light. When that sound encounters surfaces, it reflects from those surfaces and returns to the listener impressions, imprints, if you will, of those surfaces. In a very real sense, it is a way of seeing, but it is an image that is constructed from elements of sound. I speculate on how things might have been different. Gosh, you know, in some parallel universe, maybe Daniel Kish didn't lose his vision at the age of 13 months. And who is he and what is he doing? He certainly isn't doing what I'm doing. My parents did not see the blindness as an overriding factor. They definitely saw it as very secondary to my development as a person. They decided that I would need to grow up like other kids, that I would need to be exposed to the same freedoms and responsibilities and opportunities as other kids. In my earliest memories, I'm already echolocating. In my earliest memories, I'm already clicking. I was tree climbing at a very early age. Trees, fences, walls, slides, anything that was climbable. And I did run into things. I mean, I probably ran into my first pole when I was like 6. You get distracted for a moment and you find yourself kissing a pole. It's an emergency trip to the dentist and getting the teeth fixed and that sort of thing. And now we know by watching our students and my bat research and dolphin research, we know that echolocating with the environment using active signals such as clicking is an interactive process. It's like having a conversation with the environment. Every click is essentially asking the question, what are you and where are you? Fence, for example, will sound sparse, whereas a wall will sound solid. So as you want more information, you start to vary the frequency of your clicks and the quality of the clicks. So it becomes a kind of language of inquiry to gather information from the environment. Essentially, that's how flash sonar works. Okay, so we'll just do this quick and easy. Can you tell me which side?
My left.
Can you touch it? Bing, thank you. And now.
My right.
Okay, now localize where it is and then reach out and touch it. There, well done, beautiful.
Yep.
I love your power click, by the way.
Oh, I had a habit of doing that since I was six.
That's awesome. Okay, now look up and then kind of move to your right and see what you notice about this tree. You may remember it visually, but see what you can hear about this tree.
Curves.
It curves. Yeah. See if you can find where they kind of come down. There's a point where they kind
base,
of come.
The base of the trunk, like where
yep.
it all
you can, oh, right. Yeah, you found them. Yep. What we try to do with World Access for the Blind is help our students to develop an environment that supports their freedom. And then one thing that I often tell students, and this is just sort of, I mean, everyone has their own style, mm-hmm. But you may find that if you click a bit less frequently,
yeah,
you know, and let, I like to say to let it, let yourself breathe between clicks.
Okay.
You may find that, for one thing, you may find your brain tires less mm-hmm. because you can devote more processing time to each click.
Another hanging.
More overhanging trees.
I gotta carry a machete next time.
Yes. I'm with you on that.
It isn't all just about throwing skills at a student. It's about facilitating the development of a culture that supports the development of those skills. I am blind as a result of retinoblastoma, which are retinal tumors. And I lost my first eye at the age of 7 months and my second at the age of 13 months. These are both prosthetic eyes. We have to remember that sighted children have to learn to see. You don't pop out of the womb knowing how to see. You pop out of the womb with a predisposition to learning to see. But that learning process occurs through experience. And it happened rather quickly and rather naturally because sighted society supports sighted children to learn to see, sighted children to learn to use their senses to govern their interaction with their environment on their own terms. For myself, the process was very similar. and I don't remember it. I developed my capacity to echolocate and to find my way around the environment as a fairly natural function of being expected to do so and supported to do so, and mostly people not getting in my way.
I have a cat that could eat both of you for dinner. And you too, probably.
But looking back, I can say that while running into a pole is a drag, never being allowed to run into a pole is a tragedy. Because what you're really talking about is basic human freedom. In most places, blind kids aren't even given any kind of cane training or mobility training until they're 7, 8, 9 years old. It's thought that a blind child isn't responsible enough to have this freedom, to be able to make responsible use of this freedom. It's easier to guide them around. It's easier to keep them relatively passive. Blind children kept inside, out of the light of day, out of society, not allowed to mix, not allowed to mingle, not allowed to be a part of things. And maybe we could argue that it's in their best interest, quote unquote, but is it really? Does it really come from that? Or does it come at least to some degree from our own discomforts, which we can't reconcile? Daniel Boone said something like, I've never been lost, just momentarily confused. We're sometimes programmed to feel the bite of anxiety before it's necessary. Society often programs us to do that. It programs us to be afraid of the unknown. It doesn't really help to be afraid of the unknown if you're blind. And once you get over that fear, you can pretty much master anything.